We started many, many weeks ago a long process, and this has kind of been our key verse that we have gone back to repeatedly as we've talked about why we exist and who God is as a creator and how he has created us and what that means for us. And so Paul wrote in Ephesians 2:10, we are God's masterwork, work of art. We are created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. And I've repeated a number of times that I don't think these are just generic good works that are true of all Christians, though it includes that. But we are all created uniquely for a particular contribution to what God is doing in the world. I found this week, as I was just doing some reading for this Sunday, this quote from a New Testament scholar from a previous generation. But he said, diversity, not uniformity, is the mark of God's handiwork. And we've used that word diversity a number of times recently. It is so in nature. And so as we looked at the creation story, we just reminded ourselves of the amazing diversity that God has built into this universe. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of just different kinds of birds, let alone other kinds of animals. You know, hundreds and hundreds of, well, no, that's an exaggeration, I don't know that. But even like a rose, there's many, many different kinds of roses besides different kinds of flowers, besides different kinds of plants. You know, and I pointed out, if you go down, you know, where are we exactly? Go down that way a little bit to the Central Market, you know, well, it's kind of cold now to do that. Go down there in the summer and just see all the massive number of different kinds of vegetables and fruits that you can get even here. You know, I mean, that's just the diversity that God has built in to this amazing universe. So this is the way it is in nature, in God's world, diversity. But he says, so it is in grace too. The diversity, not uniformity. And that should especially be true in the Christian community. And so as we've been moving through this series, the last few weeks we've been looking at spiritual gifts. And repeatedly you see this tension or this dynamic between diversity and unity. There's got to be unity. There's one body, and all the parts have to work together. But the parts have to be different for the body to work. If everything is the same, nothing works. It only works when there is diversity. And the body of Christ only works when there are differences. And it will never work if everyone is made to conform. It will never work. It only works when there's the diversity operating with unity. With that in mind, last week we begin I mentioned a number of different gifts that Paul begins to list, and my point in showing these different lists of gifts was just to demonstrate the diversity that Paul has in mind. So in 1 Corinthians 12, Paul gives several different lists of gifts. This is his first list, and he gives a number of different gifts here. And then a few verses later in the same chapter, he gives another list, and it's a little bit different. And then in the next few verses, he gives almost that same list, but slightly different. And then in Romans chapter 12 that we looked at several weeks ago, Paul gives another list of gifts, and once again, it's different. None of the lists are exactly identical, and the gifts generally are not in the same order. And I just pointed out that to try to put all of this into a box is going to get beyond what Paul is trying to do. All he's trying to do, I think, in all these texts is say, here are some of them, and this should kind of get your mind rolling to think of all the more and more diverse gifts that God gives to his people for his body to function and for his body to do what it's supposed to do in the world. And so there's this variety of gifts. I don't think these are all of them. These are just examples. Now, as different scholars look at these gifts, and you know, I mean, it's kind of the scholar's job to analyze and to take apart and try to put things into packages that help us to understand it, and that's a necessary process. But there's always a danger of, you know, we create our own kind of system there wasn't necessarily what was in Paul's mind. And so, you know, one of the ways that, scholars talk about these gifts or try to divide them is, you know, you can divide them between, for instance, there's a number of speaking gifts, and then there's other kinds of helping or serving gifts. So I pointed out a few weeks ago in 1 Peter, when Peter mentions gifts, he just talks about those who speak and those who serve. And so those could be sort of two big categories of gifts: speaking gifts and helping gifts. Other people, you know, maybe divide these by ones that maybe appear more supernatural, you know, that maybe have no connection with some sort of natural gift, like maybe speaking in tongues or miracles. And then in another category, there are those that might seem more natural, like giving or helping or that kind of thing. So that's another way that these gifts might be divided. But personally, I'm not so sure that that's the way Paul would see these gifts, you know, to divide them into categories. And it might be helpful for us to try to understand the text, but that might be going beyond what Paul has in mind. Another problem with understanding these gifts is, how do we even define them? And I mean, I've read, like, for 1 Corinthians, I've read, I don't know, you know, the way my mind works, a massive number of commentaries on 1 Corinthians 12. And of course, every commentator, because, you know, they're writing a book and it's got to be published, they've got to say something about these things. But for the life of me, I think I'm dead certain that almost every commentator will define some of these gifts a little bit differently. And when you read them, they all make sense. They could be right or close to right. But on the other hand, they're all kind of a little bit different. And very few of them can say, you know, here's the biblical reason why this is what this gift is. So for instance, I could not tell you exactly what is the difference between a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, and prophecy. You know, there must be some kind of difference, maybe. But it's hard to define that, and Paul never defines or explains those gifts. In my mind, I just kind of see it more as overlapping circles where they just kind of, word of knowledge, whatever it is, bleeds into, you know, word of wisdom, and that bleeds into prophecy, and that bleeds into teaching. And again, to say, this is the gift, and you've got this gift, and this is the box, and it's going to look like for you, is probably not what Paul is trying to do here. In any case, I say that to say that, you know, if someone was hoping I was going to give some clear definition of some of these gifts, you're going to be disappointed, okay, because I can't help you with that. And the truth is, I don't think I can suggest someone who can help you with that. Okay. I can suggest some really good books to read which will help you in some way, but to give you a definition of some of this, and now I got it, it's completely clear, and I know that this is the biblical definition of this gift. I don't think it's out there. At least I've not found it, you know, after a few years of doing this. That being said, that doesn't leave us just kind of up in the air with nothing that we can hold on to. So I'm by the end, I hope you will have something concrete and usable. I'm not going to end with, well, I don't know, so let's go get coffee. But what might help, you know, to make this practical is to understand a little bit about what's going on, why Paul writes this. And in doing that, we can see, I think, rather clearly what is important to Paul. And if we get what's important to Paul, then I think we will get what's important to, even for our own community. Paul writes this letter, and the church had written him a letter asking about spiritual things. Most translations have it spiritual gifts, but there's not really the word gift. It's spiritual something or other, spiritual things. And so Paul starts out in like 1 Corinthians 12 with this, you know, now concerning these spiritual things that you asked about. Because this church was especially concerned about spiritual things. Whatever those are, this church wanted spiritual things. They wanted to be spiritual. And so their word was kind of built on the word spirit and being spiritual. And it seems like in this particular church, you know, what many of them determined was a sign of the Spirit was speaking in tongues. You know, whatever that might be. And it might be one of the reasons why some people had grabbed onto that particular gift is this. I mean, there was, in Corinthian culture and in ancient culture, status was very important. I mean, it was everything. What is your status in society? You know, where do you fit? And in the Corinthian church, probably a lot of people were fairly low status people. Slaves or very poor working kind of people. Then there would be a few more wealthy people who had houses and that kind of thing. And it might be that, I mean, it was the case that one thing that some people found in the church was a new kind of status. They found a community where the world's view of status, you know, was not front and center and central. And so it could be that there's some poor people in the Corinthian church who are low status people in society, but they've joined a different kind of community in the church where, you know, there's different values at play. And it might be that through, let's say, speaking in tongues, they achieved or felt they achieved a new kind of status. In the world, I'm low status. In the church, I'm high status because I'm high spiritual. And everyone can see that because I speak in tongues. And so it might have become, for some people, this is a way they could establish their status through this one particular gift. And if this gift is like the most supernatural, most special gift, and if you have this gift, well, there you are. There's your status. You know, and so it might be that some people were making this one gift, speaking in tongues, to be the most important. And so as I pointed out, probably the reason Paul puts that gift last is not because it's absolutely the least important, but it's just to remind these people, some of them, if you're thinking this is the pinnacle of the Spirit, just to get you to think a little bit differently, I'm just going to put it down here for now. And as I said, to another church, Paul might put these in a different order. You know, there might be some churches that would take the gift of teaching and need to put it, you know, way down here, where everything is just teaching and the teacher. You know, and sometimes that gift gets over-exalted. And so to another church, Paul might, you know, put it at the bottom of the list. But the point is, this church, some people were overemphasizing a particular gift. And Paul is writing to correct their thinking because he wants some different dynamics to be going on in the church. And so what Paul goes on to do is to say, okay, if you're interested in these spiritual things, rather than being so interested in this gift of tongues, think about prophecy. And one of the ways he never exactly defines what the gift of tongues is. He never exactly defines what prophecy is. But we can begin to take a few steps there to see some of the ways he contrasts these two gifts. So the gift of tongues was sounds, but unintelligible sounds. You could tell someone was saying something, you know, but you couldn't interpret them. Jules, is Jules here? Yeah, there's Jules. She comes up to me and she has this great conversation. She's got gestures. She's going on and she's saying something. I don't think it's a gift of tongues, incidentally. You know, but they, to me, unintelligible sounds. Probably Jerry and Christine can interpret her words a little better than the rest of us. Maybe
very
not.
Spiritual.
She is indeed. But all by itself, it sounds that other people cannot understand. Whereas prophecy is articulate speech, words in a language people understand. A little bit in another slightly different context, Paul compares it to angelic utterance. Tongues to ordinary human realm. I'll skip that. Tongues is addressed to God, prophecy addressed to other humans. Tongues mainly edifies the speaker, builds up the speaker, whereas prophecy edifies others. Now, by itself, this isn't going to define for us exactly what tongues are or prophecy is. And as a matter of fact, when Paul begins to talk about this gift of tongues, he talks about kinds of tongues or species of tongues. So it might even be this gift of tongues, again, whatever it is not, you know, we can't exactly put it in a box. It's just this. It might look different from person to person. Okay? But Paul begins to say that, okay, if you're interested in doing something spiritual in church, maybe rather than speaking in tongues, think about another gift, prophecy. And the main thing I want us to get today is why. Why is it that in this context of the Corinthian church, he's urging prophecy rather than tongues? If we get that why, then we might begin to know how we can actually behave in, you know, in our own community without necessarily trying to define exactly what this gift is. With that in mind, I want to turn to 1 Corinthians 4. And then, again, if you happen to carry your Bible, I know most people don't. Some of the text will be up on the screen, not much, but 1 Corinthians 4, I'm just going to read the first five verses. Paul says, pursue love. And that's the first thing the Corinthian church needed to hear. It's mainly about love, not mainly about your gift, but mainly about love. And all the gifts need to operate in the community of love. Yet earnestly desire spiritual things. That's okay. You're interested in spiritual things. Go ahead. Desire spiritual things. But especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands. In his spirit, he speaks mysteries. That's great. You know, but again, no one understands that. But one who prophesies speaks to men for edification, exhortation, and consolation. One who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. Nothing wrong with that. But one who prophesies edifies the church. Now, I wish that you all spoke in tongues. That's great. There's nothing wrong with the gift of tongues. Okay? That needs to be heard in some churches. There's nothing wrong with that gift. It's a gift that God gives. So Paul says, I wish you spoke in tongues. That's great. But even more that you would prophesy. Greater is the one who prophesies than the one who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets so that the church may receive edifying. I think when Paul says greater is the one who prophesies, he's not saying greater in some absolute scale. He's not saying a greater Christian. He's not saying a more spiritual person. But when the church gathers, the greater gift, the more important gift when the church gathers is the gift of prophecy. In that context, the gift of prophecy is the more important gift. It's the greater gift. Precisely because it is the gift that edifies other people and not yourself. So Paul says, man, when I'm by myself and praying, I might pray in a tongue, and that's great. Okay? But when the church gathers, Paul is concerned that our thinking be different. When we're gathered with who? With other people. And when we're gathered with other people, we have to be honest with you.
This is chapter 14.
Yeah.
Because those who have Bible now are very stressed. They are in chapter 4.
Oh, sorry, chapter 14. Sorry, thank you, Anders. So that's actually a great illustration of a point I'll make in a moment. So thank you, Anders. So chapter 14, 1 Corinthians 14. Very good, yeah. That would be a whole different sermon there. So, I probably have notes for that somewhere too, but not this morning. Okay. 1 Corinthians 14. Here's the thing. Three times in the first five verses of 1 Corinthians 14, Paul talks about or uses this word edification or to build up. One who prophesies speaks to men or to people for edification and exhortation and consolation. The next verse, one who prophesies edifies the church, the other people, builds up people, not himself or herself, but others. Down in verse 5, so that the church may receive edifying, building up. Again, a few verses later, verse 12. Again, chapter 14, verse 12. Since you are zealous for spiritual things, since you are really keen on being spiritual, seek to abound for the building up of the church. And then again in verse 26, let all things be done for edification. Now, this is clear, okay? And this is my point. Exactly what the gift of tongues might be, not completely clear to me at least. Exactly what the gift of prophecy is, not 100% clear. You know, even if it is definable, I'm not sure I can. But this is clear, okay? It's quite clear what Paul is concerned about. What he's concerned about is when the body gathers, that the body is built up by every person being involved in that process. So that's why in this context he says, if you want one of these gifts, I'd rather you gift of prophecy or some kind of related gift to that, because that's something you speak to people, they can hear and understand and can use and might be built up. But again, that's the point. And this is clear. This is clear. So I'm going to suggest that rather than trying to precisely define what prophecy is, if we can understand the purpose of it all. And going back to verse 3, there's these ideas of to build and strengthen, to build up. Okay, that, you know, for those of you where English isn't your first language, you know, edify might be a word that you don't normally use. It's just, I mean, the building is sometimes called an edifice. You know, something that is built up, a structure that's built up. It's got a foundation, it's got walls, it's designed and so forth to build something up. Paul in chapter 8 of 1 Corinthians says, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. So it's not just kind of, you know, complimenting people so they feel good about themselves. It's not creating a bunch of empty people that maybe look big on the outside, but inside there's nothing there. It's laying a foundation and giving strength to people. Building something in a person that will last. Making them solid, whole people. Or exhorting them, or to console and comfort. Basically, it's just offering pastoral care. And of course, that phrase can be problematic because, you know, we often think of a pastor is someone has an official position, you know. So here, you know, if someone said, who's your pastor, probably by default, my name would have to come up because, you know, no one would quite know what other name to fill in the blank with, okay? But the truth is, pastoring people is something everyone can do. All of you can pastor the person next to you. In fact, it happens all the time here. In a few minutes, we're going to dismiss, and people are going to, you know, gather in groups and eat and talk, and some will be sitting here and talking, and there's going to be a tremendous amount of pastoring that's going to be going on. And in fact, it's going to be probably better pastoring than I am managing right this second. Because it's going to be more personal and face-to-face and maybe more direct. I'm not minimizing my particular role, okay? I think God has given me a role and he's given me certain gifts and whatever, you know, I'm not even sure what to call my gifts, but whatever you call them, I'm going to, you know, until God tells me to stop, I'm going to, you know, use my gifts here. But a lot of pastoring goes on here and needs to go on. Because if I'm the only one pastoring anyone, then, you know, then this church is gone. And no one is going to be built up in the way they need to be built up to live their life day by day and week by week. It's only going to work. This body is only going to work as all of us think about this, again, I'm not worried about the particular title. I think the whole point is go about in love, serving and building up one another. And what you'll all discover is God has given you some kind of gift. God has given you the Spirit so that what you are doing actually makes a spiritual difference. I mean, that's the good news, that we can contribute. We can contribute, and the Spirit is the one who's going to actually bring the fruit. And all we need to do is love people and get involved in their life, to build them up, to exhort them, you know, maybe words of strengthening, you can do it, or stop that sometimes. Or consoling and comfort. If we go about doing this, we will find that our spiritual gift, whatever we might want to call it, is being used. The Spirit is using that. Quickly, I want to kind of do like you can see the next 5 minutes is sort of parentheses, and then I'm going to get back to trying to be very, very, very practical for you, I hope. But possibly a fear that some people might have in speaking to others in the church or to giving some kind of word or whatever is because you might think that, you know, what if my words, you know, lead someone astray? What if I give maybe some bad advice? You know, if I'm giving pastoral care, maybe I'm not qualified to do that. And maybe there could be some damage that I might do by saying something that turns out to be wrong. Okay? And this is the beauty of the body. That if we operate our gifts in a body, the body provides a safe environment where spiritual gifts can be responsibly used. And you see this in chapter 14. So for instance, in verse 29, Paul says, let two or three prophets speak. Now, the early church was probably a good bit more lively than we are here. We're not, you know, between 10:30 and 11:45, we're not, you know, the most lively kind of group here. And maybe that's a function of my personality. I don't know. But the early church probably had a lot more people doing things. So Paul says, let two or three prophets speak. And then let the others judge. That's a very important word there. And one of the things I've been saying, kind of a subtext, has been keep the Spirit or keep spiritual gifts in their place. And one of the dangers, you know, especially of using the Corinthians' favorite word, like I said, they kind of like the word spirit and being spiritual. As I'll say in a moment, Paul liked a different phrase, but one of the dangers of talking about spiritual things or spiritual gifts is that if it's like, well, the Spirit says this, then, you know, end of conversation. Which is true. If God speaks, then we know. The problem is, all our gifts are filtered through fallible human instruments. Okay? So Paul says, when a prophet speaks, let other people think about that and judge that, whether or not, yes, indeed, that is from the Spirit, or maybe I'm not so sure. I mean, you know, I don't know if you've spent a lot of time, you know, in the church and listening to other Christians and experts and various kinds of leaders, you know, if you think, you know, you hear some things and you might think, oh, I'm not so sure. That doesn't seem to quite fit with some other things. And you might think, yeah, but this is, you know, this seems to be a spiritual person. He's a leader and other people look to him. And so, you know, maybe I just have to do what this person says, even though it doesn't quite seem right to me. Or there's some other good Christians who are like, yeah, I'm not so sure. And I'm saying, if there's some other people who are like that, I'm not so sure that's the Spirit, then listen to those other voices. Years ago, when we were in America and we were, waiting, trying to raise money to get back to Latvia, we had a person who had been involved in our church, a good person, a very spiritual person, a couple who, who I think had generally often, more than most Christians, would hear from the Spirit and would say that. I think they were gifted with a certain kind of spiritual insight. But I remember getting an email from this couple and just saying, maybe it's not time for you guys to go back to Latvia. Now, because of, that person's spiritual experience, I took that word very seriously. I looked at it and thought, maybe we need to consider this. But I did not get any confirming word from anyone else. No one else was giving that message. There were no other signs that were saying, no, maybe don't go back to Latvia. So I concluded, I think in this case, this good and spiritual man just got it wrong this time. Just this time, got it wrong. So we went back to Latvia, and I'm still 100% certain we were supposed to come back to Latvia then. And in this case, he got it wrong. I'm glad he said what he said, and the whole point is he could share what he felt the Spirit was saying with safety. I hope that I was going to think it through and not just say, well, there's a word from God, I'm going to do it. Okay? This is the way the body works. And so, you might think you have a word for someone, then speak it. And if it's the wrong word, someone else might help and correct that. It's the way the body works. Then in verse 33, Paul says, God is not the God of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Four times in the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul reminds the Corinthian church that, wait a second, guys. You don't have just your own little church here in Corinth with your own little special spirituality, but you actually belong to a larger body of Christ. And if what you are doing is totally out of step with, what almost every Christian everywhere else is going, maybe you're right and everyone else is wrong. That's possible. But if you are out of step with pretty much everyone else, you need to ask yourself, am I the one who's actually on the wrong steps? I need to reevaluate what I'm thinking if my thinking cannot be matched by, kind of the rest of the church. I'm not saying that the church is always right. Obviously, that's not the case. I'm just saying the body of Christ provides the safe environment, these tests, where we can think about, what it is that the Spirit is saying to know whether or not it truly is of the Spirit. Another verse in 1 Corinthians 14. This is going to be, for some people, if you didn't know Paul said it, you might think, well, there's an unspiritual man there who's saying this. But Paul said, brothers and sisters, don't be children in your thinking. In regard to evil, yeah, be like babies. But in your thinking, be mature. Use your minds. Grow up in your thinking. I mentioned that the Corinthian church seems to like this word spiritual, being spiritual. Paul uses their word, some, when he talks about these gifts, but Paul prefers a different word, a word that's based on the word grace. So Paul would probably not talk about, if you were speaking English, spiritual gifts. He would talk about grace gifts. Gifts that grace gives. And in Paul's mind, part of his point would be, we need to see a lot more of life in terms of a gift of God's grace. And not divide, here are spiritual things, and here are natural things. Spiritual things maybe are spontaneous. If it's thought out, well, that's less spiritual. I think Paul would say, no, it's all a gift of grace. Your mind is a gift of grace. Use your brain. Keep spiritual things in their place. I'm not saying that, you know, your mind now is God. If the Spirit speaks, you've got to do what the Spirit says. But there's always a question, do we know if this is the Spirit or not? And we test that by all the gifts of God's grace. Our mind and our experience and our brothers and sisters in Christ. And the church as a whole. All of these things are gifts that grace has given for us to live our lives effectively in this world. I just have this fear that I'm not sure if I'm connecting or getting what I'm saying, and maybe you're like, I'm not so sure about it. Well, question what I'm saying. All I'm trying to do is to get us to see that we put spiritual things in a category, and we eliminate a lot of things that somehow become not spiritual. I mean, you know, a classic example would be the preacher who just gets up in the pulpit and, you know, the child rules. He has some things to say to me. And it seems spiritual. I just, you know, I get up in the pulpit, I'm just going to let the Spirit speak to me, and I'm just going to say whatever the Spirit says. Okay, is if that's more spiritual than, you know, earlier in the week, sitting down at your desk and studying. You know, why can't the Spirit also work in a library or at your desk or anywhere else that you are? Okay, the Spirit isn't just for these particular spiritual times like standing before a pulpit. He needs to be active in all of our life. We need to be listening to Him in all of our life by all the different means that the Spirit might speak. Okay, that was my little parenthesis. That's really not the main point I want to make. Let me get to that. I want to give you a simple outline that I think will be usable to you. And it came from something I heard years ago, and a few of you people, you know, maybe Andis, who I've known for a long, long time, might have heard this, you know, 12, 15 years ago. But I had a mission leader in our mission who gave just kind of three short phrases that have just stuck in my mind and been very helpful. And it just goes like this. Pay attention. Help where you can. And tell the truth. Pay attention. Help where you can. And tell the truth. One example he gave, he's living, American, living in a little village in Germany. And some young guy opened a coffee shop in that little village. So this guy, mission leader, he paid attention. Okay, here's a guy trying to open this coffee shop. Okay, help where you can. So he started to go to that coffee shop regularly to support it. He started to write his blog from that coffee shop so he could say, this is where I am. And then being there in that public space, that gave him opportunities to speak the truth. So with that in mind, just thinking about spiritual gifts and how, you know, what is important to Paul we can apply, I want to suggest first, just share in people's lives. One of the things I did find in common with, as people talk about like the gift of prophecy, is that they operate in terms of interpersonal relationships. Now, me as a teacher, you know, I might sometimes get asked to go speak somewhere else. So I occasionally speak here or there or another church or whatever. And there I probably exercise the gift of teaching more, where, you know, I take the word, I take the basic gospel tradition, you know, try to make it clear and make it generally applicable to people fairly widely. Okay, but because I might not know people very personally there, you know, it might not have a direct impact. Okay, but prophecy is probably more personal. It's a more direct word to people. Okay, so they operate, the gifts need to operate in terms of interpersonal relationships where you share in life and you pay attention. That is, you listen. So it all starts first with listening, being a listener. You will better know what to say, we will better know what to say as we are better listeners, and share in people's life, not necessarily impose your life on people. This is how I do it, you've got to do it this way. Let me tell you this story, you know, let me interrupt what you're saying so I can tell you my story, you know, about my experience. Just first share in people's lives and listen. Paul said in chapter 12, actually, verse 26, if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. You're sharing in people's lives, and you share in their lives, not talk them out of their feelings. Here's another problem with being spiritual. You know, someone is going through some kind of suffering, a loss. Someone in their family died. And some other spiritual Christian, oh, don't cry. We should rejoice. We're Christians. We should rejoice. And, you know, you'll see that person one day in heaven. Christians shouldn't weep. That's too spiritual for Paul. Suffer with those who suffer. Don't talk them out of their pain. Share it. Sit next to them and share it. Yeah, I don't need a card, Jules. Thank you, though. But you want me to take it.
Share it.
Yeah. There you go. It's not okay.
It's an opportunity for you to share.
Okay, this is this is going to go back. Thank you, Jules. You're a great example of everything. Share in life, pay attention, and help or speak where you can. First, help, you know, and I say that because, you know, sometimes our speaking isn't what is most helpful. You know, sometimes sitting in silence is most helpful, or serving, doing something practical. But at the same time, sometimes silence hurts as well. You know, and learning to speak words that can help, well, where you can say something helpful, then do it. And tell the truth. You know, if you think God is speaking to you, that God has a word for someone through you, then all you can do is speak it. Again, you can't be paralyzed by fear. What if it's the wrong word? It might be the wrong word. You can only learn by practice, but it's in a body. If it's the wrong word, then there's other people who can help with that. There's other words. And we protect one another in this way. Just sharing people's lives. Pay attention, help or speak when you can, and tell the truth. And all I want to say today is this is easily doable. In about 5-8 minutes, every single one of you can do this. And if you just do this, I'm pretty sure the Spirit will become a part of that process and will make a difference. Okay? So practice this today, 5 minutes, wherever you are, let's practice this.